Well, good morning, First Baptist. We're glad you're here today in worship. So let's stand and sing as we praise our God today by singing, Blessed Be Your Name.
All the time. Yeah, he is so good. What a great song. Amen. Amen. Some of you all were here last night and got a little crazy, I heard, and had a good time. Praise the Lord for that. I'm glad you got to enjoy yourselves, and we get to worship Jesus today, and I hope that you're here for Bible study. And I know our teachers have been always working hard to present a great study and a great lesson for us to learn from, and God has been so good. And I do want to just thank you for being here. If you are a first-time guest, thank you for being here. Thank you for just coming and enjoying some time worshiping the Lord together. If you've never done this before, in front of you should find a connection card or close to in front of you. Hopefully there's one right in front of you. Do me a favor, fill that out and give that to me. I'd like to go ahead and just welcome you here personally as well. And thank you for being here. I'm going to read out of Psalm 103. So I want you to do me a favor. Go to Psalm 103. I'm going to tell you a quick little story about that. On February 9th was my dad's birthday. My dad would have turned 76 on February 9th, just a few days ago. And I was looking through his Bible, which I'm so glad I got his Bible after he became a believer in Christ. He got this great Bible and all kinds of notes in it. And as I was thumbing through it, out comes a card that has Psalm 103 that written in his own handwriting. And it was so meaningful to me to read it. And I thought, boy, you know, what a great verse. Well, this morning as we were praying, and we had such a strong prayer time at 8:30 in the morning. And by the way, you know, you all are welcome to join us at 8:30 in our prayer room right outside the doors here of the sanctuary on the left. But the Lord just placed on my heart to read that too. And so I was reading that, and then we come in here and we're singing this song. What a wonderful song to sing, and a great blessing to hear this. So the Lord's definitely speaking to me about this psalm. So if you've got your Bibles open to Psalm 103, just follow along as I read it. You'll know this real well. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits, who pardons all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with loving kindness and compassion, who satisfies your years with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagle. And let me carry us over to, you don't need to turn to it, Isaiah 40, where it says, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. Amen. Father, we praise you for your word. We praise you, Lord, that we can, as we get ready to take the Lord's Supper. If you have your Bibles with you or right in front of you, you can grab one. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I really want you to look at this passage of Scripture on the Lord's Supper, and I'll explain a little bit about that in a minute. But 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to read out of, starting with verse 23. And some of you got to punch that into your phones. I know how you are. All right, you there? I have a seat, gentlemen. Thank you. Paul writes, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself. And in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup." So what does this mean? Well, first of all, we understand it to be a symbolic representation of who Jesus is. We are showing through the elements, through the bread and through the juice, the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. They are not the actual body and they are not the actual blood, but they are representative of who Jesus is. They are a symbol of who Jesus is, so that we can do what Paul says, proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So that's the first part of it. Second, it is a communion. We call it that, and sometimes we use the word communion for the Lord's Supper, and that's okay to use that word, because it really suggests that we are one together as we take this Lord's Supper together. That we have a common bond. And what is a common bond? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen? So when we believe in Christ and we trust in Christ and we understand that his gospel is that saving grace which saves us, not our works, not our baptism, nothing else, just Jesus, we take this symbolically to say we are one with Christ and we are one with one another and we are proclaiming it forever. You know, as we look at this and we see the color of this and think about the blood of Christ, there was no forgiveness of sins without the atonement. You say, why do we have to have that? Why do we even have to talk about that? Well, it's because Jesus thought it was important enough to die on a cross, to take those nails, to die for our sins, to be that intercessor between God and man, so that all who call on his name shall be saved. Let's take this in remembrance of him.
My own wife doesn't hand me the microphone yet. No, I'm just... I'm going to be reading out of Acts chapter 19, verses 23 through 29. If you have your Bibles, please turn there. There, I got it. And this is what it says. "About that time, there occurred no small disturbance concerning the way. For a man named Demetrius, a silversmith, who made silver shrines of Artemis, was bringing no little business to the craftsmen. These he gathered together with the workmen of similar trades and said, 'Men, you know that our prosperity depends upon this business. You see and hear that not only in Ephesus, but in almost all of Asia, this Paul has persuaded and turned away a considerable number of people, saying that gods made with hands are no gods at all. Not only is there danger that this trade of ours fall into disrepute, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis be regarded as worthless, and that she whom all of Asia and the world worship will even be dethroned from her magnificence.' When they heard this, they were filled with rage, and they began crying out, saying, 'Great is Artemis of the Ephesians.' The city was filled with the confusion, and they rushed in with one accord into the theater, dragging along Gaius and Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companions from Macedonia." Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much, Lord, for this time to worship you. Thank you for...
Where all love I ever
By the way, guys, if you are not involved in our men's Bible study, we just started the Tony Evans Bible study called Detours, and I'll talk about it in a few minutes a little more, but it is a great study, and it's a study on the life of Joseph, and I don't know about you all, but I can really identify with Joseph. Being the guy who, you know, he thinks something's going to happen, and a detour happens. I don't think I'd react as well as Joseph reacted, but boy, he can really teach us a lot. And it's a great study at 6:30 on Mondays. And we are in the library for now, but I hope that we have so many men that we're going to be outgrowing it, because we were starting to get a little tight already. So praise the Lord for that. So Acts chapter 19, I'm going to continue our series on It's Not Your Life, and it isn't, amen? It's God's life, it's His life, and that you get to live for Him. But, you know, when we go through life, we get some difficult times, don't we? There are ups and there are downs. There's always going to be those mountaintop experiences. There's going to be those valleys that we go through. I can tell you that just seeing in my own life and having friends and family that go through these great times, and we're shouting to the mountaintops how good God is, and then we're in a valley and we're screaming to God when it's so difficult. And we all go through that. And you may have more serious issues one week than others, or one day than others, or one month than others, but times can be tough. They can be difficult. I met a young man over the weekend at a Bible study I was at who is a citizen of this country. And please, I'm not getting political, so don't even start to think that. But he's a citizen of his country, but his mom took him over. She was illegal, and he was born here in this country. And he's struggling because he can stay, but his mom might not, and he struggles with that, and he was at the study, so we got a chance to talk and to explore some of these things and to really see the sovereignty of God in those things. And you know, when a going gets tough, sometimes all you can do is look up to the Lord and to seek the Lord, and that's really what we should be doing, amen, and to seek what God wants us to do. And it's very easy to say, well, you know rules are rules, blah blah blah, but boy, when you see a real person, you see real issues, it's really hard sometimes. Well, here we have verse 22, not verse 23, but I want you to look at verse 22. You all got your Bibles open? Okay. In verse 22, it says that Paul had been traveling around, and it says that he stayed in Asia for a while. And that, when they're saying Asia, they're saying Asia Minor, they're talking about Turkey. And he's staying in this place. But I love how verse 23 begins this explanation of what's going on with the simple words, "There is no small disturbance concerning the way." What is the way? The way was the way of Christ, the gospel of Christ, Christians. What a understatement that Luke has here in chapter 19. There was no small disturbance that occurred because of the way. And then he begins to explain what is exactly taking place as an illustration of the small disturbance that is also happening in other places. Because anywhere the Christian worldview begins to penetrate, there's going to be conviction, there's going to be pushback. And so when they are sharing the gospel, there is pushback from people who are not believers. That makes sense? Why? Well, because there's Christians who are the salt of the earth to them. And by the way, those of you that have had your cars for a very long time and you drive on salty roads, I know they're not made out of salt anymore, but still, what happens to your cars? They start to corrode. See, that salt can be convicting, can be a little corrosive to someone who wants to just live their own life, right? But that salt can also be preserving, and to preserve truth and to advance truth and to make sure that we are preserving what God has in the gospel. And so we see this salt and light, so to speak, going out to this place in Turkey, in the area of Ephesus. And we see that the Ephesians are beginning to get into some kind of a disturbance. And so when we look at this kind of example, what we're going to do today is we're going to go through five examples of how it applies to them then, but we're going to see five responses we're going to have now. And boy, I'm going to go plowing through this, so y'all hang on, okay? But when we see this, we see these issues taking place, we're going to see reactions and pushback, and these things even happen today. Five things, what we might see. Got it behind me. The first thing we see is this thing called false worship. False worship. Verses 23 through 26 tells us this. We see this man named Demetrius, who is a silversmith, and he makes these silver shrines of this goddess named Artemis. Now, some of you may have Diana in there, but the truth is, I double-checked in the Greek, it actually is Artemis. You say, well, what's the difference? Isn't that the Greek god of the Roman god? No, that's not, because the truth is this is an Ephesian or a goddess of Ephesus that they have created. They have their own little private god out of Ephesus, and they made this temple that was the temple of Artemis. And so Demetrius was a silversmith who made a living making silver shrines or statues or idols out of this false goddess Artemis. Now, Ephesus was the capital of Artemis worship because it was their god. They made this. They created this. They said, oh, this is the one that fell from the sky and has all these things that show fertility. So they make these statues, and they place the large statues in the Temple of Artemis. Now listen to this. The Temple of Artemis was it was one of the seven wonders of the world, in fact. It was so big, it's bigger or as big as a football stadium. Now you think about that. In that time, in that era, to make a football stadium-sized building was truly a wonder of the world. And the Ephesians were really proud of this. And so they elevated this Artemis worship high in the air, because this Artemis worship was this thing that they could, at least in a sense, pronounce their independence from the Greeks, who dominated culture, and the Romans, who dominated everything else. And so the Ephesians were really proud of this Artemis god. It was like independence in a way. If they couldn't be free in most ways, at least they can be free with their little god, Artemis. So they had a lot of pride in this goddess, okay? And they had a festival every year in their honor. And when you have a festival, you have souvenirs. And when you have souvenirs, you have people trying to cash in. And guess who got to cash in? The silversmiths. So that you go, and it's like going to Disney World, right? You go to Disney World, and you get these little plastic figurines. You say, oh, look at this. I got a little plastic figurine to take home, right? And the joke used to be, you'd go to Florida, and I see them in Florida when I grew up there. They'd have these gift shops, and they had these statements that said, my parents went to Florida, and what was it? All I got was this lousy T-shirt, right? So they'd have these souvenirs, and they would take them home, these little statues, and these statues would be something they would bring home, and they would take these statues and they would put them in their home, and they would hope that they would have prosperity and fertility, and their farms would be in abundance, and their families would multiply, and so, that didn't really happen, but it didn't matter, but the silversmiths made money. So there's a lot of money to be made. And so we see here, Demetrius, who is a silversmith, is realizing that, this Paul guy, he is, he's cutting into our livelihood here. Now, church, you can do a lot of things with people, but when you start cutting into their wallets, what kind of reaction do you think they're going to get? Ain't going to be a good one, is it? And so Demetrius goes to them and he appeals to them. He says, he is cutting into our livelihood. But even more so than that, he says, not only that, but he's turning them away from God, our gods that are made with our hands, because he says those gods made with our hands are not gods at all. Well, no duh. Truth doesn't matter there. What matters is his emotion. You see, they are worshiping false gods. Today we see people worshiping false gods. We see whole economies based on false god worship. When Teresa and I visited Nepal a few years back, we saw goddesses and god worship. People would come home for their festival and they'd have 2 weeks. It was like Christmas and Thanksgiving and New Year's all the same week, okay? And they people would travel home and they'd have these big festivals, and it was all about this basically goddesses and gods. And the Nepali Christians said they are worshiping demons. Today, we also see worship of things like celebrities, gambling, sports. We see worship of people playing sports. We see worship of money. We see worship of possessions. We see worship of our homes. We see worship of traditions. We see worship of politics. Hello? If you can't shut off Fox News or MSNBC or CNN or whatever you prefer, you got a problem, okay? You need to get out of that world and get in the real world and get in your word, right? Amen? We see that today. I was so encouraged, though, today to read an article in the Cincinnati Inquirer. If you have not read that article about Michael Lorenzen, anybody see that? Yeah? Yeah. Good. Wasn't it good, brother? I said I wouldn't call you out, too, didn't I? I did. I sure did. But, Michael Lorenzen is a pitcher for the Cincinnati Reds, who is a devout Christian. And Zach Buchanan, the writer for the Cincinnati Inquirer, wrote an amazing article on Michael Lorenzen that came out in the paper. And I think it came out today. It was on my tablet today, so I'm assuming it came out in print today. And he talked about Michael Lorenzen's faith in Jesus Christ. How hell is real. Imagine that. What? That Cincinnati Inquirer telling us the hell is real. Yes. Michael Lorenzen had a full platform to say his testimony in Jesus Christ. And by the way, brother, you'd love to hear this. While he was on a pier, smoking and joking literally with his friends at the age of 17, a guy comes up and says, "Hey, I'd like to talk to you about God." And his friend said, "Yeah, sure." And they started making fun of him as he was talking about God. But Michael Lorenzen listened, prayed to receive Christ, and was changed ever since. Today, he writes in his Bible, and he has in his Bible, "My sport is not an idol. Baseball is not an idol." He uses it as a platform to tell people about Jesus Christ. He's a guy who lost his father last year, and his first home run of his career is what he hit when the first day back in tribute to his dad. Amazing stuff. But yet he knew that his worship was not to be in a false god, it was to be in one god. That's what we might see today, though, is false worship. Second, we also see a blind allegiance. People sometimes get so wrapped up in their false worship, they begin to have also blind allegiance to symbols and thoughts and traditions of their day. And we see this in what Demetrius says to the people in verses 27 and 28. Look at that. Look in your Bibles there. You see it? He says, "Look, not only is there danger that this trade of ours fall in disrepute, but that the temple of Artemis is regarded as worthless, and that she whom all of Asia and the world worship will even be dethroned from her magnificence." Now listen to this. He was saying, not only does he say Artemis was a false god, that's not really as important as, look at what it's going to do to our temple, our wonder of the world, that everybody worships and admires. It's not going to be shiny and white and beautiful. It's going to be ugly and disgusting and worthless. Well, that pierced them to the heart. It didn't matter as much about Artemis, but it mattered that Artemis and all of the traditions went out the door. And so their response, look at what they respond. They heard this and they were filled with rage and they began crying out saying, "Well, great is the Artemis of the Ephesians." You see that in there? They're worshiping the God and taking great pride in this false God that's local God. He's making headway with the money appeal, but Demetrius now is appealing to traditions. Not only does it cost some money, but it kind of says to them, "Hey, your temple's not going to be any good. People aren't going to look at you. They're not going to come to your city. They're not going to see how valuable things are. Everything that you've known throughout your lives is gone because of this Paul guy." And they freak out. What a perfect example of a person using power to manipulate people. And what a perfect example of ignorant, blind allegiance by people who didn't care about the truth. All they cared about was tradition. Hello? That happens to us today. Sometimes we take these positions without really understanding and thinking about what's going on. I met a man one time in a convenience store. I was at a convenience store standing in line, and this is in Daytona Beach. This is a very long time ago. And this gentleman is in front of me. He turns to me, and he pulls out of his pocket, and he has a tract, and he says, "Hey, I'd like to tell you about Jesus Christ," and he's sharing the gospel with me. And I'm like, "Well, praise the Lord, you know, he shared the gospel with me, that's great." And I said, "Hey, listen, I'm a believer, I go to church." And he says, "Oh yeah, where do you go to church at?" And I told him, North Peninsula Baptist Church. And then he says, "Well, let me tell you this," and he pulls out another tract, and he starts witnessing to me about how I should use the King James Bible. I'm like, wait a minute, I'm thinking to myself, are we on the same team? Y'all are laughing because that's, you know, uncomfortable, right? Without even thinking about it, he didn't even think about it. You know, listen, you can read the King James Bible. It's okay. I love the poetic form of the King James. If you're reading it, read it. Please do. If you're reading the English Standard Version Bible, and sometimes I'll do it, and a few weeks ago I actually read out of it, and some of you are like, "Where are you at, Pastor?" But you know what? Read it. It's great. What's important is not the translation as much as the fact that you are reading God's Word. Now, do not go to the Jehovah's Witnesses and get theirs, because theirs is twisted, okay? Don't read the Book of Mormon, because that's twisted. But read a translation you can find in the Lifeway store. Great. Find something that works. But don't dare start to convert somebody else in another tradition that's not yours and thinking that mine is better than yours and I know it. That's blind allegiance. Third, rebellious spirit. Now, you would imagine that when he appeals to the temple of Artemis, that everybody is going to freak out, and that's exactly what happens. They're screaming, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians! Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" They're filled with confusion. In verse 29, they rushed. Everybody rushed to the theater. Now, this theater held about 25,000 people in it, and they drag along poor Gaius and Aristarchus, and they go in there too. And Paul wanted to go in, but they said, "No, Paul, you can't do this. Don't do this. You're going to be in trouble. It's not a good thing." So the Asian leaders of Turkey, they stopped him from going in there, but this crowd is really, really riled up. They're really riled up. They're filling this theater, and people are shouting. Gaius and Aristarchus are in there, but here's what's really weird about this. I want you to look at verse 32 and underline that. Because there's all this commotion, there's all this screaming. Imagine 20-something thousand people in this theater together, and people are screaming, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians," and "Ho, ho, ho, okay, you know? And there's all this confusion and all this. It gets so great. Look at verse 32. "They're shouting one thing and some another, for the assembly was in confusion." But I want you to underline this. You got it? You ready? "And the majority did not know for what reason they had even come together." Yeah, that's a mess, right? What are we here for? "I don't know, but I'm looking for a fight." Remember junior high school, right? You ever want to get a bunch of kids together? All you had to hear somebody say is "fight." "Fight!" Right? Y'all had that when you were growing up? I don't know what it is about junior high school. It's just like, you know, wow. Right? The problem is with all these humans and all of us humans is that we have this rebellious spirit, and sometimes people just love to rebel and see rebellion in action. Why? Because we have sinful hearts. I'm not picking on you if you're a graduate or getting ready to graduate, young men, young ladies. But I don't know about you, but when I was getting close to 18, I couldn't wait to get out of the house. Amen. I couldn't wait. I remember thinking to myself, "Just wait." Y'all ever do that? How many of y'all did that? "Just wait till I turn 18. I'm out of here." And then what happens? The economic reality gets connected with the reality, you know? It's like, you know, that mom and dad ain't so bad. All right? Why? Why do we want to do that? Why do we want to rebel? Why? Because it's in our spirit to rebel. Adam and Eve was in their spirit to rebel. Once they rebelled, it went to Cain and Abel. Once they rebelled, it went all the way down the line, even to Noah and his sons, which spread it through the planet. We're rebellious spirits without Christ. And we see that today. People get riled up for no reason. They don't even know why. Another human condition we see around us is, you see those three: false worship, blind allegiance, rebellious spirit, is rampant racism. We don't have to go far around here to see racism. We don't. In verse 33, it says, "Some of the crowd concluded it was Alexander, since the Jews had put him forward. And having motioned with his hand, Alexander was intending to make a defense to the assembly." Now look at what happens. "But when they recognized that he was a Jew, a single outcry arose from all of them as they shouted for 2 hours, 'Great is Artemis of the Ephesians.'" We see in the midst of the confusion, because Alexander, for half a second, got the crowd's attention. They saw he was a Jew and they totally disregarded him. Why? Because of racism. They were second-class citizens, and when he was a Jew, it got worse, and they screamed. They united them together against the Jews. Great is Artemis of the Ephesians, and it just got worse for 2 hours. More rebellion, more blind allegiance, more false worship, and it's all intersected with racism. And yesterday we see racism. We see racism over skin color. We see racism over economics. We see racism over educational levels, socioeconomic. When I grew up in South Florida, I remember seeing recruitment cards for the KKK. Now, it's disgusting to say that, but I saw it. I remember seeing being harassed because I was lighter in my skin color than the next guy, or darker in my skin color than the next guy. People don't know what to do with me, especially in Florida. You know, I'm a lot more lighter here than I am in Florida. They didn't know if I was Cuban. They didn't know what I was. I would have people speaking to me in Spanish, and boy, I better learn Spanish quick, right? But listen, why do we do that? Because we rank things sometimes. Socioeconomics and all that. It disgusts me that we look, even here in Cincinnati, that a Nazi swastika was painted on Hebrew Union College. It's gross. It's disgusting. It makes me sick when all white people or all black people or all Latinos or all Asians are grouped as if they all think and feel and act the same way. It angers me when people are overly naive or overly awkward, or worse, overly hateful towards a people group. It doesn't matter who shows hate to another. Hate is hate. Racism is racism. Racism of white skin or black skin or brown skin or whatever skin is still hate. And rampant racism exists today as it existed then. Last, we might see people who seek discord. What we see here is the final occasion where the town clerk finally says to them, listen, y'all need to calm down. And I'm going to paraphrase it in my translation. Okay, this is my translation. Y'all need to calm down, he said. Okay? He said, let me tell you what's going to happen. If you don't calm down, they're going to think that you are starting a riot here. These guys have done nothing wrong. If you got charges against them, you bring it before the courts. Let's appeal to the rule of law. And if you do not do that, they're going to think you're rioting. You all need to be done with it. And then he dismissed them. Verse 40, we're in danger of being accused of a riot. These people here were bent on discord. They were looking for a fight. They were looking for something. Jude calls these type of people, if they were believers, as springs without water. These are the people that you might say, sticks and stones might break my bones. They'll go out and get some sticks and stones. Amen? Right? Sometimes people just like to see a good scrap. I remember growing up, I grew up in upstate New York. And my parents, I'll never forget this, I was like 5, 6, 7 years old. But my parents would take us every year to see the Clinton Comets hockey team. They were terrible. They were minor league. These guys hoped to get in major league. The Boston Bruins came in as an exhibition and cleaned their clock with. I remember them scoring shorthanded, and if you know what that means. They didn't have as many players as the Comets had on there because of the penalty, and they still scored. I mean, they were just so much better than them. But the Comets were terrible, but boy, could they fight. They would play, and it was almost like you can count every period. They would play, and they would, you know, something would happen. They'd throw off the gloves, and there they go, you know, and everybody's cheering them on. I remember my mom saying, yeah! And then that's nothing compared to these. You got to remember, you got a bunch of Italian people in the stands. Guess what's going to happen? So you got fights in the stands. You got fights on the rink. You got fights. People want a good scrap. Now, these are good people. These are blue-collar men and women who really normally wouldn't really touch people. Well, maybe they would, but not too much, right? But they love these fights. Why? How many of y'all ever watch UFC? You can admit it, because I watch it. Why? If you don't like it, you probably haven't watched it. I watch it, I'm like, oh, I'm drawn to this. Why? I don't know, they're bleeding. Why? sometimes we just, our sin nature just takes over, and we just want to see that stuff. Sometimes people get involved in it and they want to gossip or get in the middle of everything. Listen, if you're in the middle of every fight or every controversy, the problem probably is you. Because you're seeking discord. So this is where we are. Paul and the church are having a really bad day. And we have really bad days too. Amen? But the point of this passage really should be, what should we do about it? We are going to have these ups and downs at times. And so let me give you five things of what we must do. What should we do in response? Well, very simple, depend on Christ. Amen? The Bible tells us that if we don't know what to do, that we can depend on Him. And Jesus says in Luke 12, He says, for this reason I say to you, don't worry about your life or what you'll eat or your body is what you'll put on. In other words, seek the Lord and His righteousness if you're worried about stuff. But He also talks about in Matthew chapter 5, in verse 11, He says, blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evils against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. For just in the same way they persecuted the prophets, they who were before you, and He implies they will do that to you. Look, when times are tough, people sometimes will act like jerks. How are unbelievers supposed to act? Like unbelievers, right? And when the chips are down and you don't know what to do, don't worry about the situation at hand. Don't look horizontally, look vertically. Depend on Christ. I love the fact that we're studying through Joseph in the Man Day Monday, the Men's Night Bible study at 6:30. Because it talks about Joseph and how the adversity happened. That was a guy who dealt with jerks. He had some brothers who just, they weren't very good guys, you know? In fact, they were pretty wicked guys. You're not going to look, how would you like to have a big brother like Reuben, right? Or Judah? These guys were awful. Awful people. And Joseph, who was a favored son, Jacob favored him. And he was a favored son who they took and they stripped his robe and they sold him off to the Midianites, and they claimed or they tried to imply to their dad that he was dead and his dad took the bait and all this stuff. They did a whole lot of terrible things. And Joseph ended up working for Potiphar as a slave and then got accused falsely of some things with Potiphar's wife, and then got thrown in jail and was sitting in jail and took over in the jail and being prosperous there. But every time Joseph got hit and got knocked down, what did he do? He got back up. He never lost what his purpose was, and that is to glorify God with his life. He depended on God, and he knew that God would eventually take him through it. And in fact, at the end, he says, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. Depend on Christ. Second, along with that is to place Jesus first. As I mentioned earlier, people have false allegiances. You see that in your notes, this blind allegiance. They're going to have that to something. It's very easy to get sucked into it. People get sucked in by culture. They get sucked in by drama. And they places people first. That's backwards because we're supposed to place Christ first. Colossians 2:8 says, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception according to the tradition of men, or the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ. My family has traditions in a home. When I was growing up, we had a turkey and a lasagna pan right next to each other. Great. When our kids got older, we always had a big Christmas Eve dinner. It was like the big deal. And for a while there, the kids wanted, we'd always give them a choice, what do you want to have? And they'd always want Cornish hen because they could have their own chicken, you know? Right? These are great traditions to remember, right? We have traditions all the time. Christmas time and birthday time and all these things. Those are good things. But look, let's make sure that traditions, whether it's home or at work or in society or in the church, don't overshadow Jesus in the gospel. Place Jesus first. Be sure you don't have a blind allegiance to something that has nothing to do with Jesus. I heard a story about a church that people had a problem, and what they did is they would come in with their coats, and they didn't have any place to hang their coats. So, and I've told this story before, but the one guy, a very creative guy, said, "Well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put some peg hooks along the wall." So he put some peg hooks so people can take off their coats. I'm going to borrow your coat for a minute there, brother. And then they can hang it up on the wall, and then it would just sit there, and that'd be great, you know? Until the controversy began. Well, Sister Mary came up and she said, "Hey, we didn't vote on this. We can't have it up there." Brother Lowell came up there and said, "That looks ugly. We're not going to have that up there." Before you knew it, you had a faction of the anti-peg Baptist church. So then you had a fight in a business meeting, the pegs versus the anti-pegs. And eventually the pegs won out, the anti-pegs left. And now there is a church called the First Anti-Peg Baptist Church, right? Well, that's not a true story, right? No. It's not a true story. But let me tell you, sometimes we get in these positions and dig in our heels for no reason. It's a blind allegiance. What are you red-faced about? The example that I had before, a Bible translation, or are you red-faced about musical instruments, or pews versus chairs, or standing versus sitting, or length of service versus, well, shorter service? Let me ask you another question. Are the things you get upset about a matter of salvation? If they're not, you need to place Jesus first. Third, commit to peace. Depend on Christ, place Jesus first, commit to peace. When people have a rebellious spirit, as we saw earlier, we are called to be a people of peace. Romans 12:18 says, "If possible, as far as it depends on you, be at peace with everyone." What does this look like? Well, let me tell you what it looks like. It looks like people listening and understanding instead of trying to force their opinions. Stephen Covey, who's a writer who wrote the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, who, by the way, is a Mormon, I will say that, okay, full disclosure, but it's a pretty decent book. One of his points is, seek to understand and then be understood. And that's a very biblical concept, actually. You know, a lot of times when I see people, a lot of the problems that people have is that they don't communicate. So let me give you something. This is free. This is going to cost you nothing except a couple minutes, okay? All right? Y'all ready for this? This is communication that you all need to understand of the basics of communication. Listen to this. You got a husband and you got a wife. A lot of times one is in the feeling world and one is in the thinking world, right? The husband didn't throw out the trash, and the husband comes home, and a wife says, "What is wrong with you? Again, the trash is piling up. It's overflowing. It stinks. You don't love me." What does the husband do? "What? All you do is scream at me. Yeah, blah, 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 blah," right? What do they do? You, I, you, right? The wife was in the feeling world, and all she did was express the feelings. Husband is in the thinking world, but then at that point he lost his cool, right? And sometimes it can be vice versa. I'm a feeler. I tend to be a feeler. I tend to think in emotions, you know. But here's the thing. When you are trying to communicate with your spouse or your child or your coworker or your church member or your friend, it is a good thing to talk across both worlds. In other words, I feel that we have a problem. I really feel like I'm doing a lot of work and yet the garbage has been overflowing. And I think if we don't get this solved, we're going to get bugs. Our neighbors are going to wonder what's going on with our house. And I think we need to take care of that. What do you think? Now it's the husband's turn to talk. "Well, I think you have a good point. And you know, I'm really tired when I get home from work, But maybe I can set it before I turn on Jeopardy, if Jeopardy's still on. Turn on Jeopardy, and I can throw out the trash then. Would that work? Yeah, I think that'll work. Whole different conversation. Why? Because they are talking across worlds. Most of the problem is people do not talk across the world, and both are talking at the same time, and nothing ever gets done. Church, a person of peace is a listener. And let me tell you the other part of this. If you are a person of peace and you want to be a good listener, and somebody tells you something that they're concerned about, you know what you want to do back? Now, let me make sure I'm hearing you right. What you're saying to me is that garbage needs to be tossed out because it's going to stink. Is that right? The wife says what? Yes. Hallelujah. I've been heard. Right? Ladies and gentlemen, this works for children and works for spouses. It works for coworkers. It works for a human interaction. Because a person of peace is a person who listens and, not parrots, but paraphrases back what they have heard so that people know that they've been heard. And then you get your chance to talk. Right? When you listen, you get a picture, better picture of what's happening. Be a committer, commit to peace. Here's a fourth one. Embrace God's design. We talked about rampant racism, and the counter to that is to embrace God's design. I want you to do me a favor and go to Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7, and I want you to look at verse 9. This is one of my favorite passages in the book of Revelation, and I think you're going to enjoy this as we read it. But I want you to think about this as I'm reading. If you don't have your Bibles open, and that's okay. If you don't have it open, that's fine, but close your eyes or something so you can really focus on this. Listen to what John the Apostle wrote of what he saw in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. And I'm going to read about eight verses of Scripture. After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could count, from every nation and all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, palm branches in their hands, and they cry out with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God who sits on our throne, and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders answered, saying to me, those who are clothed in a white robes, who are they and where have they come from? And I said to him, my Lord, you know. And he said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation, and they have washed the robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on a throne will spread his tabernacle over them. They will hunger no longer, nor thirst any more, nor will a sun beat down on them, nor any heat, for the Lamb in the center of the throne will be their shepherd and will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe every tear from their eye. These are those who lost their lives in the tribulation, who have suffered, starved, thirsted, were in great pain, the sun beating down on them. And in Christ's presence, they will not. And here's the beautiful thing about it. They are from every tribe and every tongue. Heaven has every tribe and every tongue. His church should have every tribe and every tongue. We should worship together in every tribe and every tongue. The future of human race is summarized with the joy of diversity from every tribe and every tongue at the feet of the Lamb of God. The Insanity of God movie that we're going to play in another week will have people from every tribe and every tongue. And so, church, we should weep at the thought of racism and get angry at the horror of hatred and be advocates that we are new humans, new humanity in Christ. Get over this awkwardness. Okay? Get over it. Don't think about it and love one another. and look beyond the appearances of a person. 5. Embrace God's design. Now 5 is what? Seek to love. This is a key verses at the end. Paul, if you remember, was really wanting to go in there because he wanted to make his case. But the church stopped him, and they loved him so much they were able to stop him from going in there. And, you know, that's obviously Paul listened to them. But when we see people that have this seeking of discord, you know, people that get real ugly. And I was joking about the Clinton Comets and hockey team. I mean, it really did happen, but people like to see a good fight sometimes, right? You know, listen, our response as Christians should be to seek the love. Don't appeal to that sin nature. Seek the love. Jesus says in John 13:34 that even as I have loved you, that you love what? One another. He says that all men will know that you are my disciples because of the love you have for one another. Our love should be through action. Our love should be through hugs. Our love should be through words. Our love should be through our feelings. Our love should be sharing the love of Jesus Christ with others. While we have a world of people that are going to post things on the internet anonymously because they're keyboard warriors who have no guts, right? We should seek to love them, not respond in kind. God doesn't need a defender. He needs people who love those who don't know any better. In another couple of months, we're going to start something called Mission Cincinnati. And that is a journey of love that we can have to take the love of Jesus Christ out of our homes to our neighbors. And the idea is that we start missional communities out of our homes that you can start, and by inviting a couple of people from church and the rest being your neighbors. You can't invite more than 2 people from the church and the rest neighbors to come and do a Bible study together and take on a missions project. And the idea is every week you study and you study and you study and you enjoy time together with those people, getting to know them and eventually sharing the love of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. If we follow Mission Cincinnati and we really do what God has called us to do and follow the pattern of the New Testament church in reaching our neighbors and friends and family and co-workers, not only will First Baptist Church of Mount Healthy multiply in terms of new believers, we will see the kingdom of God multiplying in our area. Now that should be exciting for you, because it excites me, because it's a chance for us to demonstrate what we're really about, and that is love. Look, when you have a tough day, when the going gets tough, remember those things. But most of all, put on love. Missy, where are you at? I know you put it up. Yes, thank you. She put up I'm sorry, I'm calling her out. I shouldn't have done that. But she puts up the signs out there that says the little letter signs. And she put on one of my favorite ones, the 1 Peter 4:8 says, put on love, because love covers a multitude of sins. That's something we should remember. Father, I just thank you for the love of Jesus Christ. And I thank you for the chance for us to respond when the going gets tough in a way.